COVID series. I'll call this the COVID series of lectures because remember, given the current situation of COVID-19, we've had to either adapt or perish. So for this reason, here we are. So the next couple of lectures are supposed to take care of what we were to do. We had about three or four major lectures to go through. And that included us looking at, of course, remember what we did last time, we finished with the normal flora. So after finishing the normal flora, we were to do controlling of microbial activity. And when you think about controlling of microbial activity, it meant we had several lectures that were remaining that were to touch on disinfectants, to touch on sterilization, some also to do with antibiotics, and also to mention how the immune system helps us to fight microbial infections, and also if it is not working naturally, how we use vaccinations and immunization programs to boost the immune system to still do the same. So for those who are new to the digital platform, most of the lecture notes will be on the digital platform, and make sure you go and be able to, by now you should have been, you should be comfortable actually using the virtual platform and be able to download some of these lectures. So what is going to happen is you're going to find this series of lectures as short clips or short videos, and that will also be followed with a short PDF conversion of the PowerPoint so that you can use them for your revision. Now remember one important thing, these are guidelines. We are guiding you through this process. One of the most important things that you have to do as a student is supplement and, of course, read books. So get books on microbiology, whether they advance, whether they introductory, as long as you are using these notes to guide you through the topics that you need to be reading, get a book and use the tool to get all the necessary knowledge that you need. So having said that, looking at what we had already done before, we had done normal flora, that was the previous, and that's what you're going to see on this end here, which I'm going just quickly to scroll through, because what we need to do right now is actually on control microbial activity, as I've mentioned here. So, but you must remember, for you to understand what is going on at this time point, you must remember one important and several key things we did a couple of lectures way back. And they were touching on transmission of sources of infection. You must be able to go back to this lecture and remember sources of infection and how microbes interact with their host. Because from there we looked at different ways and talked about their transmission modes. And most importantly, we did look at this diagram, which you call the Venn diagram, and mentioned giving several examples of bacterial, viral, protozoan, and helminthic infections, and describe how they'll enter the body and how also they'll exit the body. Those are important lectures for you to have and keep in mind as you're going through the couple of the next batch of lectures. How we control microbial infection. There's one key thing that you must be able to understand, and that is what you're calling the chain of infection. Now, the chain of infection is what is actually responsible for keeping an infectious disease within a cycle, in a cycle, and in the environment, or within a given setup. Now we are facing a COVID situation. It is exactly those similar circumstances that you must understand what you're calling the chain of infection. Now for a chain infection to occur, there are six important things that you must notice that need to be in that chain of infection. You need an infectious agent. You need a reservoir. There has to be a portal of exit. There has to be a mode in which this pathogen is being transmitted. And there's also a portal of entry. And the portal of entry is leading you to who is most likely to be susceptible. And that whole infection begins all over again, starting again with the microorganism itself, going there, creating a cycle that we're understanding as the chain of infection. Now, some of these components, which we've already described and you've seen around here, we've already looked at it when you're looking at the sources of microbes and how microbes interact with the human host. So if we go straight to what we needed to do today, then you must understand one thing. that in a chain of infection, there has to be an infectious agent. Now, who are this infectious agent? There are several, and there could be all kinds. It could be bacterial, it could be a fungi, it could be a protozoa. Right now, we have a virus that is going around. That is an infectious agent that must be there. This infectious agent is not just there from nowhere. It is being reserved somewhere. Now, the question that comes in mind is the reservoir supposed to be an animal? Or is it the reservoir? Is other individuals, other subjects? Now, is also the reservoir, is the environment also playing an important role as a reservoir? Now, do equipment and other formats also do play an important role in this infection? Now, that infectious agent is being linked to that reservoir. Sometimes you may not know the reservoir of that given pathogen because a question will arise, where does a certain disease go when it is not circulating or when it is not causing a problem in a given population? Now, from the reservoir, the pathogen must be able to exit. So whether it is from the animal or from that human who is a reservoir, it must exit through a certain portal. Now, this is what comes in mind when you're asking, is it through the droplet nuclei? Is it through the secretions? Is it through those pus wounds from excretions? Is this pathogen being shed in a stool or fecal material? Will it be coming through the skin? Now, once it leaves the reservoir, then it means one thing. It is being maintained and being transmitted through a certain medium to the other likely susceptible host. Now, that means of transmission is what we already looked at, and we asked ourselves, is the pathogen airborne? Is the pathogen bloodborne? Will blood transfusion transmit this pathogen? Will a vector play an important role? Will I be bitten by a mosquito? Will I be bitten by a sandfly? Will I be bitten, or will there be a mechanical vector? All this we tackle when we're looking at biological and mechanical vectors, which means they are linked to the current lecture that we're having today. Now, equally important, also, you need to ask yourself whether the mode of transmission is by being in contact with that pathogen. Now, having understood that, that means one thing. If it is airborne, then it must enter through a certain route in the susceptible host. So, how is it going to enter into that susceptible host? That's the question. So, are you going to inhale the pathogen? Is it going to enter through the respiratory system? Are you going to ingest the pathogen? So, is the pathogen going to enter through the gastrointestinal tract or through the mucous membrane? For example, if you are bitten by a rabid animal, or if you are getting a wound injury with the tetanus organ, the organism that causes tetanus, enter through that route. Or is it going to enter through the urogenital tract? And those are the examples. For example, when you're looking at STIs and STDs, that becomes a question. Now, once that has been achieved, then you must understand for an infection to establish, then you must be a susceptible host. Keyword, you have to be a susceptible host. Why susceptible? Because not everyone who gets exposed to a pathogen comes down with the disease. Sometimes it comes to not being susceptible. So is a susceptible person a neonate? Is it a child? Is it younger than, is the child younger than 5 years? Are they older? Is it about the elderly? Is it about those who have certain underlying conditions? Do they have diabetes? Do they have other immune deficient disorders? Are they immunosuppressed? Do they have other infections that are making them to be susceptible? Now, with that in mind, whoever is susceptible will be the virus, the bacteria will multiplicate them, and eventually they will shed that pathogen in one mode or the other. Therefore, eventually, what we are saying that all this creates what you are calling the infectious cycle. And as you can see here, they are linked together like a chain. Now, the most important thing that comes in mind would be, how do we break the chain of infection? What are these mechanisms that we put in place to break a chain of infection? Now, that brings you to the most important thing. This central area here, the central region here, with the arrows of course radiating. What does that mean? That many efforts that we put in place are supposed to break this chain of infection. It means if, for example, we are using chemicals to disinfect, or we are using the chemical as an antiseptic, whether we are using sterilants, be it a physical method or a chemical method, we are intending to delink one of these chains from the other. As long as the chain has been broken at one point or several points, then the infection stops spreading. In that way, sometimes the body system comes to do and help us in doing that through the natural immunity processes. But sometimes it can be overwhelmed or it is not ready that we need to use a vaccine. Now, there are times when, in addition to all those processes taking you have to give an antibiotic, you have to give an antifungal, you have to give an antiviral, you have to give something to contain the infection. That may also include certain practices that you do, for example, clearing the bushes. If you're using a herbicide or you're using an insecticide to kill the vector, you're trying to control the infection. Now, that brings us to where we are at the current moment. All these efforts are being done, but one key thing that seems to play an important role eventually when things become thick is a most important matter of isolating and quarantining the individual. To isolate means you are getting those who are with the disease and setting them aside from the rest. To quarantine means you are getting somebody who's been exposed to somebody who has the infection, but they may not be showing the symptoms, but you want to make sure that they will be free of the organism, or if they get signs and symptoms of that disease, they are not a danger to the others. Now, that, of course, will also be accompanied by constant surveillance of the disease process. Now, eventually, you must ensure that there is proper use of personal protective equipment, gloves, lab coats, face mask, face shields, N95 mask, name them. All these are important aspects that we're using to control actually this any kind of infectious agent. So about COVID, where are you going to start from? You're going to start from it being a viral disease. Where is it being reserved? We know it from certain animals. The only problem, we don't know who is the other intermediate host. We know how to leave those animals. We know how human beings may be exposed. We know the different routes. We know how it will enter into your body. So when, for example, you're putting on a face mask, you're trying to prevent its entry and also sometimes exit to cause a problem in the other individual. But we also know an important thing, susceptibility. Everyone can be exposed to the pathogen, but eventually, who is most likely to succumb to severe consequences of exposed to the pathogen? You already know the answer by now. If not, feel free to look around. There's a lot of resources for you.